Hello everyone, welcome to the third video of the class 10th history chapter, The Rise of Nationalism in Europe. Next topic is a new conservative regime after 1815. Being conservative means being traditional in your approach. When you do not want to change, that means you are conservative. So before 1815, that means before Napoleon lost, most of the monarchies of Europe were very rigid. They were against any social changes. They wanted to preserve monarchy. They wanted to preserve the authority of church. They wanted the social hierarchy to stay in the society. That means those three estate system, they wanted that to remain. They wanted to preserve property of the rich. But after 1815, most monarchies of Europe began to realize that it is good to be flexible, because the changes that were introduced by Napoleon were very powerful for the economy and for the administrative system. So they decided, most of the monarchies decided to become a little flexible. So they stressed on reforms. And what were those reforms that they wanted in their economy? They wanted to have a modern army. They wanted to have a dynamic economy. That means an economy which will allow free flow of goods, that will allow easy trade. They wanted to abolish feudalism and serfdom, which means that now the taxes will not be paid to the nobility, they will go directly to the state. And they wanted an efficient bureaucracy, that means an efficient administrative system wherein the work becomes easy. Napoleon lost the Battle of Waterloo in 1815, and the countries which defeated France were Britain, Prussia, Austria and Russia. Now these countries also had to decide what has to be done with France. France had many overseas colonies also. Many countries were captured by Napoleon. So what will be done with those countries, and what will be done by the changes that were introduced by Napoleon in France and in other countries? So these countries met to decide all this. They met in Austria, and this meeting was hosted by Austrian Chancellor Duke Metternich. And the treaty that they signed was called as Treaty of Vienna of 1815. So as per this treaty, Bourbon dynasty was restored to power in France. Remember, Louis XVI, he belonged to Bourbon dynasty only. So that dynasty came back to power in France. They ensured that now France will not be allowed to expand further. Whatever territories were confiscated by France during Napoleon's rule were taken back from it. States were also set on boundaries of France so that France cannot expand. For example, Netherlands. But remember that Napoleon combined numerous states to create 39 German states. So those 39 states were left untouched. That means they were not broken back into those numerous states. Now let us understand all this through a map. This is Kingdom of France. So Netherlands was set up on the borders of France to restrict French expansion. Netherlands then included Kingdom of Belgium, which is now a separate country. Piedmont, this region belonged to Italy, but it was captured by Napoleon. So Piedmont was given back to Italian princely house, and Genoa was also captured by Napoleon. It was added to Piedmont. Then the sky blue region is showing Prussia. Prussia was given some important portions on the west, and portions of Saxony also went to Prussia. So the sky blue region within Kingdom of Saxony went to Prussia. Then portions of Poland were given to Russia. Empire of Austria also got some portions of Italy. Kingdom of Lombardy and Venetia, which belonged to Italy, were given to the Empire of Austria. Then these red borders are showing the 39 German Confederation states. So this was left untouched. But the empires which defeated Napoleon, like Britain, Prussia, Russia, Austria, they became very conservative after 1815. They imposed censorship. They became totally intolerant of criticism and dissent. That means anybody who would speak against them or publish anything against them would be punished. They established autocratic governments, that means governments with unlimited power, and they tried to reduce any activity that would question their authority.
On one side, European monarchies were turning autocratic. On the other side, revolutionaries existed in most parts of Europe and they fought for creation of a nation state. They opposed monarchical forms. They wanted to change the system of government. They fought for liberty and freedom. And they even started secret societies to achieve their aims. Secret societies were like secret clubs where they met and decided a lot of things. One such very famous revolutionary was Giuseppe Mazzini. He belonged to Italy. He was born in Genoa in 1807. And when he was very small, he joined a secret society of Carbonari. But at the age of 24, that is in 1831, he was sent into exile, that means out of Italy, because he attempted a revolution in Liguria, which was an unsuccessful revolution. So he was sent into exile. But outside Italy also, he did not stop. He found two secret societies. One was called as Young Italy. It was found in Marseille, which is in France. And another one was Young Europe, which was found in Bern, in Switzerland. His main aim was to unify Italy because Italy was captured by many nations. And he was so influential that Metternich once described him as the most dangerous enemy of our social order. The conservative regimes were scared of him. Thank you so much. Do not forget to like and subscribe.